The Digital Service Act, like all other proposals structuring the digital space, which we have on the table, which are four right now legislative proposals, they are all being presented and negotiated under the lead of the Industry Commissioner Thierry Breton and the lead DG is DG Connect. But DG Justice has taken a great interest and has been an important partner and remains an important partner of DG Connect in this work, simply because these acts, all of them in one way or the other, concern fundamental rights and the good functioning of democracy, which is, of course, the core portfolio competence of DG Justice. And that's why I'm also very happy to discuss today here with you. The presentation I will give to you is the standard presentation of the Commission prepared by the unit of Prabal Agarwal, who's the head of unit in charge of this file. So let me say first of all that, here I have to ask for some understanding. The European Union, it started, and I say this also for our American audience, it started as the European Economic Community, and we are still, of course, a body which is very much looking at economic developments and the internal market. And the DSA is actually an update to an instrument which is already in place, namely the e-commerce directive. So it contains important elements pertaining to the good functioning of digital platforms as far as they are market operators. But the new thing today is that these platforms are not just platforms for trade and commerce, they are also platform for the societal discourse, the public sphere, or as Frank Pasquale called it, the electronic public sphere. We know that more or less 40%, and this is not different in the United States than in Europe, more or less 40% of citizens get their public opinion, their personal opinion on policy matters, on politics, on participation in democracy from these platforms. So the DSA therefore has a double nature. It is an instrument of commerce, but it is also an instrument structuring this new electronic public sphere. The Commission is in a very good position in terms of the presentation, because we have presented this on the request of the Parliament and the Council. There are numerous resolutions, and of course we have also studied the matter for a long time. And as I said, we are focusing here on the online platform as not only the model for markets in the future. If you look at Amazon's importance in the markets as just one model and one example, but also as fora for political discussion. The evidence which we are basing ourselves on are regular reviews and studies of the e-commerce directive, and of course a long public consultation and targeted consultation of the public, the member states and academia. And I would say this: the democratic procedure which we are going through now, and this is very important, is not just about positions. It's a finding process, because what we're doing here is really cutting edge lawmaking. We're making laws, and this is true for all of the four instruments, which don't exist like this anywhere in the world. So we are really at the forefront. And so it's very important to consider the discourse which is now taking place in the Parliament and in the Council, not just as a positioning game, national positions or the position of this or that organization, but as a finding process where we together try to find the best solutions for the challenge in hand for our society. So we approach this in this spirit. My experience as having been a lead director on many very complicated legislative files is that if one approaches the democratic process in such a way, it is really a very fruitful process, because the likelihood is that the outcome is better than what the Commission has put in. And that's no wonder, because many people contribute, and there are very good structured discussions taking place both in the Council and in the Parliament. There is no group thinking between those bodies, but I would say they are in a dialectic relationship, and that makes for very a fruitful dialectic process of democratic discourse. So what are the problems we want to address and what are the policy objectives? So first, we have identified, and the issue at hand, namely incitement of extremism is one of that, serious societal and also economic issues and harms from online intermediaries. There are illegal activities online as far as the market is concerned, but there are also activities which pertain to the public sphere and fundamental rights. And we want to ensure through the package of legislation that the platforms are platforms which respect individual fundamental rights and are also platforms which work well and support the good functioning of democracy rather than undermining it. And there is an insufficient supervision of services and insufficient administrative cooperation between the platforms and authorities. And this needs to be more seamless given the importance of these platforms in public life. And we also want to empower users and civil society to be real actors, effective actors, to become more effective actors in making sure that fundamental rights are protected and that the democracy functions well also in relation to these platforms. So let's have a look at the cycle, at the circle at the right of this to just frame our discussion a little bit, because of course, when it comes to speech and counter and extremism project, of course, is focused on this. We have to make a difference between harmful content, illegal content, and content which is not in line with the terms of service of a given platform. So first of all, let's be clear about this. The DSA does not create a new framework to attribute criminal law or civil law liability. It is also neutral as regards the question, what is illegal? Illegality of content is a matter which is left to the member states. This is not necessarily a question of law. I think in the context of the internal market, we could try to harmonize. But the Commission has a long-standing experience as, let's say, a pragmatic body of initiative. As you know, we have the monopoly of initiative for lawmaking in Europe. So this is a little bit different than, let's say, in the United States, where, of course, much of the law comes out of Congress, is proposed by members in the form of a bill. In Europe, the Commission has a monopoly for lawmaking. And, you know, we want to propose laws where the likelihood of passing is very, very high. And that's actually also the rule. You know, one lobbyist one day, and I've worked a lot in Washington and with the US government, told me as a rule of thumb, if in the US you have two senators and two members of Congress who are really against a law proposed bill, it is very likely that this will never pass. And that's why Congress is not able to deliver legislation. We haven't for a long time not seen good legislation coming out of Congress. I remember even Obama, for example, he tried to introduce privacy rules twice. He tried the Privacy Baseline Act, failed. So even when the president tries, you know, it doesn't work. In Brussels, that's different. If the Commission proposes something, and you know, in comparison to the US, to be very clear, it is very likely this law will pass. Why? Because we have a technocratic expertise which goes back for decades, and we know the system very well, and we put all our knowledge and expertise into our proposals, and we propose things after having done very intense soundings and consultations and having understood, let's say, so to say, the political positioning of member states and the members of parliament. And so to come back to this question of harmonizing what is illegal, you know, would be a nice to have, but would take years and would probably not work, because you know, this is just something where member states in the area of speech, we're talking about illegal speech, are very far apart. And if you look into the history of lawmaking of the European Union, just to give you an example from data protection, for example, in GDPR, the relationship between data protection and privacy on the one hand, and on the other hand, free speech, and in particular, the activities of journalists, and there can be tensions between those two, are also left to member states. We have not harmonized this relationship. So whenever we come, so to say, close to issues of free speech, which are very sensitive and where member states have slightly diverging histories, and the United States has a very diverging history from most countries of Europe, we in the Commission, we are careful not to go into a territory where we would probably for a long time not find agreement. So that's why we're not harmonizing what is illegal in the DSA. And the DSA is horizontal. It builds on existing liability in terms of illegality under civil law or criminal law. Right. Now, as to the content of the due diligence obligations, and this is the core of the discussion and the core of the proposal, and probably also the core of what we will be discussing. So first, the DSA makes a difference between four types of actors, or let's say has rules which apply to all intermediaries in this table right at the writer out, outing, then hosting services, online platforms, and then the biggest discipline and the most new rules are brought forward for very large platforms. What are very large platforms? According to the proposal, these are platforms which have more or less 10% of the EU population as clients, so 45 million users in Europe. Symmetrics of law is not a reality in this law. And like, again, you know, in the history of the European Union, this is nothing new. We have a long-standing history of asymmetric regulation. Namely, we put more obligations on the bigger actors because they can shoulder more responsibility than on the smaller actors. This is very important to realize. This is, the table already shows the very large platforms have much more obligations than other platforms. And this is an expression of the principle of asymmetric regulation. One can also say it the other way around. The Digital Services Act, as it renews the e-commerce directive, is developing with the history of the internet. At the time when the e-commerce directive was put in place, and in the United States, Section 230 of the Indecent Communications Act was put in place, there was a strong argument to be made that the internet is a small flower which has to bloom, and, you know, infant industry, we cannot regulate it to death, and therefore these laws were very lenient. But the situation has now completely changed. 20 years on, we see an internet which is dominated by the richest, biggest corporations in the world, top of the US stock exchange, and therefore top of the world stock exchange, if you look at it in accumulation. And these companies are able to carry a lot more responsibility. And they're also not just passive actors as they may have been thought about in the year 2000. You know, that regulation was very much inspired by a thinking in terms of telecommunications, the thinking at the time. You know, on the one hand, John Perry Barlow, we don't want any law from parliaments or governments in the cyberspace, you know, the Declaration of Independence of Cyberspace, that was kind of the music thinking from 1996. And he was very much active in this legislative debate in the US on Section 230. But the other type of thinking, and it fell on fertile ground because the argument was very easy, namely, well, in telecommunications, the telecom provider, AT&T, is not responsible for what people speak about on the telephone. And let's do it for the internet the same way. We have here a technology provider, they provide the platform, but they cannot be responsible for what people are posting. And, you know, everybody said, yeah, sure, fine. They got it through in the last moment. You know, and there we are, you know, Section 230 and Article 14 of the e-commerce directive today, the US and Europe, we share exactly the same problem. But let's be also clear, the problem comes from America. And that's why I'm so happy about the Counter-Extremism Project financed from America. You know, please bring us and help us to get a solution here to this common problem. Right. So how are we proposing to approach this? And now, let me, before I just go through the table quickly with you, and I really mean this, I think what has changed since the Obama time, and in comparison also to Obama, is that we now have in Washington many people who follow in a very constructive and fascinated way what we are proposing in Brussels. And I think, you know, in Obama's time, I was very often in the White House then. I was the Snowden investigator of the commission. I was the negotiator for Privacy Shield, which later was annulled by the Court of Justice. By the way, I already said it at the time to all political bosses, you know, this will be annulled. Well, you know, they didn't listen to me, too bad. Anyway, what was then the case was that, yes, you know, we always had a high level discourse on shared values. But when it came to the nitty gritty, there was a contrarian, atmosphere. You know, in the end, the American government did not want to do anything real. And that has changed. I think if you look now at Washington, at the Biden administration, the type of people they are engaging, the type of bills we see in and the discussions in Congress, it's a very different attitude. And I don't know whether you read this great paper by Ben Scott, former advisor of Hillary Clinton, who's very active between the two continents and now works in this foundation by Pierre Omidyar, the Luminate Foundation. He wrote a great piece and saying, well, actually the Biden administration should support 100% what Brussels is doing. Why? Because once Brussels has put this stuff in place, it will be much easier to also put it in place in America. And in substance, actually, the Biden administration should want this. And I would even say many in this Biden administration want this. You know, just to give you the taste of things, when our proposals came out, the feedback from US government representatives, as far as they have already been appointed, has been largely positive. And that's very different from the Obama times, you know. I'm just saying this here, because, you know, we need the help of everybody smart to avoid unnecessary transatlantic, you know, big words and, oh, Europe, you know, protectionist, and, oh, Europe is against free speech, and, you know, Europe is messing the internet up and breaks up the internet and this and that. That's not our intention. And we need people to explain in Washington and in other parts of the US what we are doing here, and that this is actually, if you know, if the US would do it, it would also be to the benefit of American people. And actually, it would be best for us in Europe if America would solve the problem, because the platforms are from America. So we would welcome legislative proposals going forward in Washington. Then we wouldn't need to do so much. You know, that would be the best solution. And I can offer, you know, we work with everyone in America who wants to go in this direction. In fact, I'm working with a lot of academics in America, and let's see whether we manage to come out with a common statement, transatlantic, you know, because this is the game of the day to show what we can agree on. Now, this is what the Commission aims for in terms of agreement on the very large platforms. We believe the big platforms, when it comes to hate and incitement to violence, anti-Semitism, and so on, have a special responsibility, and they must carry out under the new DSA a risk assessment, which is a systemic risk assessment relating to harmful, illegal content, but also to content which is not in line with their terms of service. And they must take systemic structural mitigation measures to deal with this type of content. So while, now let's be very clear here, while this proposal does not foresee upload filters as an obligation, we all know that these companies are using upload filters, all of them, for their business model, because they need to know what the content is people load up in order to place their advertisement right next to it in the optimal context. So they have content recognition systems. And when they are under the DSA, then looking at their risk assessment, it is very clear that they have high risks of content which is harmful to democracy, which is harmful to fundamental rights and so on. In assessing whether and what mitigation measures they have to take, they will not be able to just duck away and say, we can't do this, we can't do this, we can't do this. No, they will be held to what they can do. And so it is very possible that under this structural obligation, they may be obliged to use these upload filters, which they have, which are in place for commercial reasons, that they have to use them also for public interest purposes. So it is, how would I say this? It's not a direct obligation to do this, but when it comes to assessing whether what they do in terms of mitigation is sufficient, of course, the authorities which are called upon to implement this system will have to look at their capabilities, and they will have to look at what they do as usual business. And, my experience is big tech always lies when it comes to the capabilities. I remember I negotiated the first code of conduct on hate speech and xenophobia on the internet. And boy, were they telling me it's also difficult. We can't make a difference between what's illegal and not. And also, we don't have the technology and this and that. Well, as a law student in Hamburg, I learned whining is the greeting of the businessman. And that's not big platforms, that's Hamburg, yeah? So, I think it's very important that we also have actors like you who are able to provide public policymakers, parliamentarians, and the commission with alternative views, with alternative views on what the state of the technology is and what is necessary and what's actually happening in terms of their performance to the standards of the DSA. So, I wanted to focus on this risk assessment and mitigation part, because I think in that is the core of, when I have looked at your contribution, of what you're looking for. And it will be very important. I can only say the political process reacts to pressure. And there's, of course, incredible lobby pressure from these companies combined with the US Chamber of Commerce and, Digital Europe, which is called Digital Europe, but actually is dominated by these American companies, and if there is no counter pressure, it's very likely that the political process goes more that way than if there's counter pressure. So if you have an agenda, which I think you have, I can only say engage in the political process. This political process of democracy in Brussels is real, and it is not captured 100% by corporate America, not at all. In GDPR, for example, we had 20 activists, well, really only 20, Max Schrems from Vienna as the figurehead, plus from most member states, someone similar. And they went together to parliament and, they talked to their members of parliament as a group and individually and this made a huge difference. Without this counter lobby, counter power applied to the democratic process, we wouldn't have got through GDPR. And I think on DSA, it will be largely the same. It will be very important, since we are now here having a very German audience, to team up with like-minded people from other member states and then go collectively. And let me also say to our American audience, the GDPR was regularly supported by combined letters from 20, 30, 40 groups of American civil society who wrote to the president of the commission, Vice President Reding at the time in the lead, the rapporteur in the parliament. And these letters basically said, dear rapporteur in the European Parliament, and it went to all the members, for the following reason, we think these proposals are also good for the American people. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And that's why these organizations, the undersigned organizations, support the Commission and the Parliament in adopting a GDPR with a high level of protection, signed And then they all came: American Civil Liberties Union, EPIC, and a long list, Transatlantic Consumer Dialogue, and so on. So this is how it goes. And I can only say, more than the substantive arguments, politics is about getting organized with partners in other member states. That makes the argument much stronger. Right, so I don't want to say a lot on the governance structure. The governance structure is very much something which is, I would say, in between competition law, where the Commission is really the big chief in enforcement on the one hand, and GDPR, where largely the enforcement is decentralized. It's a little bit more centralized in the sense that the European Commission can become the direct enforcer against big platforms. This is a learning which we have drawn from GDPR, that the completely decentralized enforcement may not work with the big guys. The fines can go up to 6% of the provider's turnover, which is huge. Just to recall, it's not outrageous, because in competition law, we can go up to 10% of world turnover. In GDPR, we are at 4%. So you can see here that it is even a little bit more than in GDPR. Right. So I think this is my introduction, and I'm now looking forward to the discussion. Thank you very much.